74, mom wanted to get back to be around her mother. Dad wanted to get back to be around. didn't want to get here, so. But mom was pregnant with my sister, and she laid down this rule that if you don't buy me a house, I'm not going. They just rented down there. And that was bogus. She wanted to go. But he bought in, and he got her a house, so we're back here in May of 75. So basically 11 years that I lived in Massachusetts. And when you talk to a homegrown Vermonter, you say, yeah, I've been here for 41 years. I'm a Vermonter. He said, no, you're not. You're a flatlander. So I'm a flatlander Vermonter. So that's just a little brief background of where I came from. Jumping ahead, the more important part of my life. I didn't enjoy high school. I loved football. And the strange part is I love to learn. Just wasn't a classroom person. So I was dating this person, puppy love, in October of 1981, I think it was. And she introduced me to my future wife, Charlene. And all the prior, and I'm sure similar for almost everybody, it was always that instant crush love I was in, and it just, that's all you thought about 24/7. That's the way it was with the person prior. And she crushed my heart a week before my birthday in January. I woke up devastated. I mean, completely. I was working with my uncle on this farm up in Cal, but I'm never dating again. No way, no hell. I hurt so much. Done, done, done. And he was laughing it off. No, I'm serious. It hurts so much. But I always later used the hurt meant you felt something. That's the important part of the hurt. You had something, at least to you. So no matter how much the hurt hurts, it meant something. So about 2 months went by. I had skipped so many classes that I had 2 classes left. And that was in the morning. And there was English and social studies in the morning. So come lunchtime, I'd walk through and grab a lunch. I saw Charlene sitting there by herself. Didn't have a whole lot of friends in school. Didn't matter to me. And that's amazing because how much friends mean to me now, but that's the second one. I see her. That puppy thing didn't hit me. Just the one to sit down. She's sitting there. I know she's going to get kicked in later, but she has this half a sandwich. Not half a whole meat, half a breaded sandwich with a thin slice of beef. And I'm looking at that, I said, 4 loaves isn't even an appetizer. And this is their meal. I swear to anything that I had nothing, no intentions whatsoever when I sat down. Come back to the sergeant, check out again. No intentions. It was something to do. Because I had nothing rest to do that rest of the day. This probably went on for a week, maybe my time frames are off, but it was cold. She said, well, I got to go to class one time. I said, I got nothing. Yeah, and I swear again, the before crush I talked about, it was mad 24/7. I thought about you all my whole type of thing. Serious. That's how bad it was. It wasn't. Walker, left. Didn't think anything of it. Came back the next day, just walked back. Didn't think anything of it. Nothing. One day, we're walking down the hall to our class, and without looking, we pulled through yourself.
Thing.
you're fortunate to find one, sometimes you're not, but they're there. Because I think about her even to this day, when she's not with me, constantly. She's on my mind. Do things and I think about her. I take a letter, I text her. Eventually, because she's busier than I am, she will put that to me, but I'll say, what took you so long? Understand why I'm doing what I'm doing. It isn't to be a jerk. It isn't to, I'm the boss. You have to do what I have to, do it. It's that I want you to get back to your rooms. I want you to have as much fun as possible, as safely as possible, and get back to your rooms. So when I say thank you for your time, even though you're the one with the citation, you're the one holding the beer, and I wrote the citation, because I am taking your time, and I'm hoping the interaction that we had meant something, as small as it could be at that time. And for the most part, and there's a few faces I see here that can verify this, that first citation led to something. Didn't always take that citation, but it led to an understanding, it led to an appreciation on both ends, especially on my end, back to the student body. Tremendously respect for every one of you, what you, who you are, what you can be. And I just believe in my heart that I play a part in that, and the other officers do, and the faculty does, and the other staff does, and help you get to where you want to get to. Everyone here is working hard to have it so that you get to where you want to get to. So that's the respect, but thankfully it is. When you end up with a situation that wasn't so respectful, it sours the rest of the night. There's no question about that. And when you deal with 6 years of overnights like I did, mornings is really nice. Getting here at 5 o'clock and seeing all the lights off, and that's very nice. Right before the switchover came, I did tell Charlene that I'm having mixed emotions because there is less interaction, so I'm going to miss that part. And that is so important. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that. It just, there isn't enough otherwise.
Speaking of the interaction, it seems like students on this campus don't really have that much contact with staff members. You have more contact with faculty members, but you're one of those people that you yourself make the effort, and other students also make the effort to be in touch with you and have an interaction with you every now and then. What do you get from this? Why is this so important? Student contact.
Basically, my whole adult life, I tried to make myself, and by no means 100% perfect person, a leader, a role model, someone you can trust that what I'm telling you is the truth. I coached Little League for 15 years, and I was more emotional at the end of that than I am here when I said I was done, because I tried to treat everybody equally and have them learn something, and in hopes that down the road it meant something to them. One very quick story, just there was a student that his mother talked to Charlene there. She said that he called me very happy, because this person was playing ball in high school, and he was asked a question, and the would never do it, but you, it's in your back of your mind, that simple gesture, the simple gesture of coaching this person and trying to teach him, and then he passed that along. Those are the things that matter and always have. I don't know what better way to describe it, but every one of us impacts each other somehow, some way. I don't want to get too low here, but my son-in-law's brother passed away recently, too young. I went to the wake, and I was just awestruck of how many people that this one person touched. Lines, hours of lines. People from UVM, we went to college, people from the high school were able to hear, coaches from here, friends from where else they went to. I mean, it's just, I noticed the whole gamut, different ages. That one person touched that many lives to take time to go pay their respects for somebody that they liked or loved. Mother was on them nightly, lovingly, homework done. And I was there if I had to. Choice as much as possible of what you want to be, and you have a choice as much as possible of where you want to vacation. Instead of the work pick you and the vacation picks you, you get to do that. The opportunity is more there with that degree, with that goal in mind. And I know for a fact it worked because my youngest son had written a paper for school, and he didn't know I saw it. My wife gave it to me. Basically, harped on the fact that working in the barn, being 130 degrees, the sweat was pouring off you, stank, made him try harder in school.
So,
playing the girls.
I know that you've run your own business for some time, and since this is a center for social entrepreneurship.
started in 93. I was a cattle inseminator, deer cattle inseminator. And I had done that for a company from 84 to 89. Then I took a little hiatus and I started my own in 93 from scratch. And it brought up to 150 accounts. And again, it was basically coming in, telling me what I was going to do, and delivering up on that promise. Not cutting any corners, not shirking any responsibilities. And also giving back. On their birthday, they would get the most expensive bull that I had and the arm service for free. And that was $53. But that was my present to them and my thank you to them. But I think they appreciated more at Christmas time when they got my wife's rolls and fudge. They always got that also. But you have to give to receive. And you just can't keep taking from someone. So you give back, you show them you appreciate what you're doing. And especially the person who can't quite afford that better. Well, and I always explain it this way real quickly. The companies use the best male and the best female to make the progeny for the future best ones. So why aren't you using the best one? But they're doing that same thing. So that was another opportunity for me to get back to them. Before I forget it before we run out of time, because someone has things to talk about.
So
Bjorn Peterson had left me a message, told me I had to tell this story. So we had a good chat one day, and I told him the story of the wedding ring. Back when we were engaged, we had no money. The dollar dance paid for our time at Holiday Inn in South Burlington, a bucket of chicken that we ate in the room. That's, we had the money. So leading up to that, we an expensive jewelry book, and we sold to some friends who we knew why they were buying, they're helping us out. And we sold enough to get this ring. There was a wedding ring, but it must have been a cigar game. So, of course, not long after that turned her finger green, it wasn't a ring. So, because we had children early, we pitched everything toward them. And our Christmas gifts to us was something we could use, a razor, a shampoo, but the kids saw them, us getting presents. So they were happy, we're happy, didn't they? We've got to focus on our children's needs and wants. So this one time, 91, I finally had enough. It wasn't expensive, but it was still finally solvable. Able to get a ring. And this Christmas ornament that sealed perfectly, you couldn't see anything. And we had silver bells on the tree, so I hung it on the tree. And there it was, she had no idea. So I was Santa Claus, I passed the presents out. Finally, I said, oh, there's one more present. And the kids were all excited, and she's kind of with me. With the tree. So I grabbed this silver ball and handed to her. She goes, oh, that's so nice. And she's playing up for the kids. I know exactly what she was doing. Oh, thank you so much. And all of a sudden, she noticed a crease. And she opened it up, and there was the ring. Something that wouldn't turn her finger green. So that was where we were.
I didn't know you were such a romantic ball.
Down the line to flag football, fifth, sixth grade, seventh, eighth grade. Up to college, I've done some of the Middlebury JV games in the past, UVM club games. Also been involved with the semi-pro clubs that are in the state for several years, officiating their games. That gave, as an official, it was almost like being a public safety officer. Because that gave you access to young minds that you were trying to keep safe, but also hoping they enjoyed the game. And from that day one that I started, that's the outlook I took, was I have to appreciate the rules, but when I see something that didn't impact the game, I will talk with you and say, hey, your hands are out here, just hold them, get your hands back in here, so it won't be holding. Things like that, just little teaching moments. And that's when I applied for this position, talking to Director Berkshire, she had asked me what I brought, and I told her, I said, is the years of Little League interacting with that age group, the years of football interacting with that group, college and semi-pro, so it's a large group of people that you've dealt with, and you know, interact with and communicate with to get through to football officials similar to the public safety officers that work here. We're not out there just to throw a flag. Let the game happen, officiate what we have to, especially the serious things. So when I came to this position, just to jump out of sports for a second, that's where I took this position in my heart, was got a thing to do, but there's a way to do it. It's the interaction, it's to try to get them to understand, which sometimes with enough alcohol, the understanding doesn't get through. But usually the next day it did, because in most cases a note will come back apologizing for the actions and appreciation for the kindness and respect. That's all we ever ask. If we're going to give you a ton of respect, just give it back. And we'll be real small. But sports is basically life. There's challenges, there's rewards, there's failure to get back off the ground. That's why sports means a lot to me, because it just mirrors life so closely a lot of times. So if I don't see $1 million, that Tom Brady gets. Once you break that bond of trust of what you are saying to me is true, it's hard to get it back in the bottle. Integrity is, you can't be taken from you, you give it up. So you have to keep your integrity intact by being honest, by being truthful, no matter what the consequences are. Because usually, in almost all the cases, the consequences are not that bad. But typically, and most politicians have found this out, the cover-up was Richard Nixon's still president back in the day, he didn't cover things up. So I've tried to make that statement over and over again, that you are the only one that can probably your take. Nobody can take that from you. And once you give that up, it's hard to get it back. Once you told me the truth that, yes, Officer Paul, I did it. The next time I come by and something happened, you happen to be there, did you do it? No, I didn't. Okay, I'm leaving until I see more evidence, because you haven't lied to me. You owned up to what I knew you did. You owned up to it instead of trying to obfuscate it to something else. It was his beer. I just hold it for a second. I mean, I can bore you to death with all the... I was just holding it for a friend. I only had it didn't do it, and how people believe it stinks to sit there and say, no, I didn't have that look or have the talk. Continue questions, 10 more questions of you saying no 10 more times instead of the no once being enough. And we need to build trust between ourselves. One no should be enough. You haven't lied to me before. And you're saying you were involved, and I have no other evidence, so okay, thank you. Thank you for your time. That's exactly what you get from me. I touched before, and I said, well, you're here, and the smell's here, and so did that help you? Did that deserve it?
Yeah, definitely. Actually, I want to spin up about that a little bit, because we often, you know, this campus is a little bit of a battle for the students, especially, and you asked a little bit of an outsider, how would you describe the student body here? Are we honest? Are we respectful? Do we listen to each other? Do you have any advice to us as to what we could do better?
You are honest as a group. And by no means, there's never 100%, but there's sometimes mitigating circumstances, as I mentioned before. Unfortunately, alcohol plays games with certain people, and so that does play a factor. I believe, given the same situation without the alcohol on board, the response would have been differently. The disrespect would not have been there. So it's hard to say that the group is disrespectful or not. We're a very respectful group. The whole college, I've been here for 6 years. It's funny because Thomas says to us junior seniors, you've been here forever. No, 6. Forever for you because you've been here for 3. Yep. Very respectful group, very honest group. Just that stray every so often that I continue to beg you that are here and pass it on to your friends. Just own up to it. Don't give that up because it is so important. The thing that I would change, and I'm not saying there's a big change, but maybe you were going to already go there, but I'm going to jump to the polarization. For the last at least 20 years, our country has become so polarized, and it's gotten to the point for me that it's scary. It's just too far. Nobody's listening. Everyone's talking. And somewhere we got to break that and break through. We got to start listening. I'm not saying you have to agree. I'm not saying you have to change your mind. I'm saying listen and learn. Because that's the only way we can learn is to listen. I told you the story there yesterday, and I don't recall the person in politics or not, but he told the story about how every chance he got, he would take a seminar of a person that was coming from the opposite end from where they were. And when they could, they took courses of professors that were on that same. Two things that he felt he got from that. He felt stronger about his convictions because he's listened closely. Because you're in a seminar, so you're just listening. You formulated your arguments against by listening. Not during the talk, but listening. So he felt stronger about this is why I believe what I believe. And that is so important. Because they listened first, and then they understood what they were coming from, and they respected that person's opinion, but they felt different. And that's great. That's where we should be. The second thing is, he said, on a few things, I started softening my position because it was making sense. And we're not there right now. I think we used to be, but I know it's kind of like this curve that we've had throughout the years. They always call these times of politics so dirty, but when you read about the 1820s and 1910s politics, that was downright nasty too, if not nastier. And they were slinging mud at Andrew Jackson's wife and so on. So just because you're in a time and it feels worse, it might not be, but that means, okay, now we've got to fight to change, not make it so worse. I'm sorry for preaching, but that's just what I've always felt, that nobody's listening, everyone's talking. It's time to start listening.
You said that you're listening. More questions?
I certainly consume alcohol, but not a lot. I'm more of a social drinker. But my unwind is, say, my son's friends come over and watch football on Sundays. These kids grew up basically me. I'm like their second father. He told me a lot of times. So we jab each other because there's no worry of he hates me. He's mean to me. We just pick on each other when we can. We'll jump on this person, everybody piles on as far as the jabs. And that is my one way of my unwind, is just to be able to joke around, goof around, without fear of they're going to take it personally. It's all good fun. Charlene and I, we try to go out from time to time, just the two of us. We take our families out together. Also, last year we went all as a family, and her brother and sister and families went to Niagara for 3 days. So we're out to Niagara Falls. So it was quite the plan. It was like 20 of us or so, from 2 years old to 51 years old. I thought for sure her sister's husband was older than me. He had to break my bubble. Yep, my sports is my unwind. My officiating football is my unwind. I used to coach basketball and little baseball forever. That was my unwind. I was involved with the Talent First Response Squad as an ECA level first aid. That was an unwind because I was helping out, being available. Just watching TV with my wife. This Is Us. We started watching that this fall. And if I dared watch that before, I might as well just not wake up in the morning.
Anyone else?
Yeah. So last year we had an extended game of Words with Friends, which you kicked my ass in. In what other ways does...
You can't tell the score or not?
No, it was like 400, 500, like, I maybe had 250, and it was, you kicked my butt. I was wondering, in what other ways does a competitive nature play out in your life?
In every way. I was joking with Choney there on Facebook a while back, because he had awesome pictures of him, the long distance running and doing and stuff. I said, man, I said, I don't want to see me on the track with you because it'd be so ugly. But I was still, if it were ever to happen, I would still, you'd see me just blue in the face trying to, as he's going. Yeah, so, and if you take me up on one-on-one basketball, there's going to be a few elbows. My son learned the elbows long ago. There's a Robert Parrish move from the Celtics back in the 80s. He pinned the elbow and then threw a spin around the person. So you learn a little how that moves. And the fingers in the chest move. Yeah, they're trying to dribble. Yeah, no.
I guess the lessons don't mess with Paul.
Yeah. You'll probably win, but it won't be.
So a few
already said this, and I might have said it in nauseam to you, Thomas, but the night is too long without that fun interaction. To be able to take the joking around. How's everything going? Oh, you're the cause of trouble, Christian, aren't you? Quick story. Not embarrassing. Not embarrassing to me, maybe, I don't know. So we got a new sergeant, and Christian walks out of that water, walks over, we do the man hug there. All of a sudden, I get a kiss on the top of the head, and he walks away. The new sergeant Ricks, he just kissed you on your head. Thomas, and the next person I see is, and I don't bring the citation, that's not fair. So it was always maybe consistent, but respectful and polite, and as we learned each other, maybe a little fun with it. And in most cases, again, as I mentioned early on, I don't recall the citation, but they do, and we talk about it, especially their senior year, they're reminiscing. Yeah, he got me over here. Yeah, I thought I got away with it, but no, old eagle eye, he got me. But I thank you so much for those comments, because it feels mutual. That group that you're talking about yourself, tremendous people.